Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Life is tough. Life is tough for everybody. Regardless of your socioeconomic status, everybody faces challenges in life. It's tough for everybody. But everybody finds a way. In some of the advertisements for, particularly since we have a speaker from the Food for the Poor, and those that sign up and give them their address, about every week and a half, we get volumes of stuff from Food for the Poor. And the pictures in there, the little children are just really pathetic looking. I mean, they're gaunt and just starved and all, and yet, that there are other pictures of similar kids in similar situations, for instance, who are spending their day scavenging in the city garbage dumps in third world countries and elsewhere, looking for either something to eat or something that is valuable to sell. Okay. And when the photographer or the person comes and talks with them and they take pictures of it, and they're happy. I mean, there's smiles, they're made a game out of looking for it. They have taken a very terrible situation and they're having fun because they're kids. They adapt. Well, adapting is not always easy. Sometimes it takes a while. For instance, the people of Israel had just left slavery in Egypt. They prayed to God, please deliver us from slavery. We've been here for, I don't know how long, a while anyway. And it's been 400 years since Joseph, where they were, like the family of the vice president of Egypt. And he had a lot of power and they had a lot of prestige because they were Joseph's family. And this is 400 years later, now they're slaves. And he prayed, and they let them out of. He sent Moses to lead them out of Egypt, out of slavery in Egypt. And they didn't know that they were going to be in the wilderness for 40 years. But only less than two months into that, not days, into their beginning journey, they started doubting whether this was a good idea or not, because first thing, they ran out of food. I mean, it was a big crowd, and out in the wilderness, there's not a lot of food, just to have, no fast food places, and they ran out from what they brought. And so God gave them manna. Oh, they complain about that manna after a while, it's just sickening. This is all we got to eat, manna in the morning, and that's all we got. Morning, noon, and night, manna, going. They complained to Moses. Moses talked to God. God sent them quail, all right? Quail, little bird things. Every night they had enough. They were eating quail. Get around the campfire, and manna, all that. Great. Well, it worked for a while. Then they got to another place, just out part of the wilderness. There was no water. Now, you can live without food a lot longer than you can live without water. And so this was, they just raked. As Moses said, they were up to the point of stoning him. And so he comes to God and says, we got a problem here. And God says, yeah, okay. I'm going to show you the rock. And I'm going to stand on the rock there, and I want you to strike that rock, and water will flow through to give water to the people. He says, take that staff, the one that you brought out of the wilderness when you came from keeping your flock and went into Egypt like I told you to, and then that was your sign of authority. That one that you threw down, it became a snake, and you waved it, and it became there were frogs everywhere and gnats everywhere, and the water turned and all that stuff. And says, yeah, he says, yeah, I know that. And the one, you know, the one that you, when you came and the Pharaoh's armies were chasing you and you came up to a water hazard and you couldn't get across it, so you waved your wand and the waters parted and you went across on dry land, and as soon as everybody was over there, and Pharaoh followed you in there, and you waved your magic staff again, and the waters came and killed Pharaoh and all this. Well, that one, go and strike that rock with this one. And he went, he did that, and struck the rock, and it was fine. Okay. Well, as I talked with the kids, the rock is an object lesson. And the object lesson was, because the New Testament calls it Jesus is the rock. You know, we have the song, Rock of Ages, cleft for me. It was a forerunner. It was an object. It was a spiritual object. And that's why, and the New Testament calls it a spiritual rock, Jesus is. He's not that rock, but he's that spiritual rock. And he was to be struck once for all humanity. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, he died for us one time. Because see, that was the problem with Moses, is in the object lesson. Later on in life, they had needed water, ran out again, and God came and he says, okay, this time go and I'll show you the rock, and this time don't hit it. Okay? Because the rock was a part of the object lesson. And the object lesson was that the Christ, the promised Messiah, was only going to die once. But Moses got caught up in the emotion of the moment. He had been programmed before with that great event when he struck the rock last time. And you remember what happened. He went, and instead of waving his arm like he did for the water to part, he struck the rock again. Well, God says, I gave you the object lesson for a reason. Say it the way I told you. Do it the way I told you to do it. And oh, by the way, your time out is going to be, you don't get to go to the promised land. You'll go to it and you'll see it, but you're not going to be able to go into it. All because he blew the object lesson. By the way, that's the preach to me part. That's the preach to me part. You know, what is God's word saying? And how does he tell us to do things? And how do I tell you God tells you to do things? Now that I tell you, then it becomes your responsibility to not mess up the object lesson. And that's where we come to the end of the sermon. We talk about you're the object lesson. Okay. Now, but the concept was that this water. See, water is an ongoing theme in the scriptures. From the separation of the water from the land, of the waters from the sky, and all that. The waters were in creation and God created it. And then the next big water scene was the flood. And even in the baptismal service, we have that the flood was the, you know, God's purifying the world. And it's an object lesson that in baptism, he purifies us. So it's this water thing. And then they go through the rest of the story, and they go to Egypt, they come out, and then there's a rock that the water flows through it, which God says, God will provide for you. He's provided for you manna, he's provided for you the meat, and now he's providing for you with water. God provides. Trust him. But they were still saying, oh, we should never have left Egypt. We should have stayed in Egypt. I mean, we had all sorts of meat. We had all sorts of vegetables. We had all sorts of other things to do. We was ever, you know, slavery. Okay. Life's tough, folks. Life is tough for us, too. Life is tough for everybody. Because everybody gets used to and makes it. Well, it's the old conventional wisdom. If it doesn't kill you, it makes you strong. Makes you stronger. You know that. Well, this woman at the well that Jesus talked to, these were Samaritans. Their problem, as far as the Jews concerned, it was racial. See, because they were descendants of Jews who weren't good enough to take off into captivity to Assyria and Babylon. And these are the guys that they just left because they were laborer type. These weren't the artisans. These weren't the money people. These weren't the skilled. These weren't the leaders. These were the hoi polloi. Okay. And so they left. Well, they didn't have much choice for brides. So they married the people of Samaria. And that's where the Samaritans. But they had this Jewish heritage because they had the books of Moses as their religion. They didn't have the rest of the prophets and the rest of the poets area and the histories, but they had Moses. Okay. And see, this was, of course, post the division of the they worship in the north. So they had a history. They had they knew of the coming Messiah. But this racial thing between the Jews and the Samaritans, that's why, you know, Jesus used the Samaritan as an example in several of his parables and events in his life. The good Samaritan, who was, you know, all this Jewish man who had been beaten and robbed and left to die, and all these honorable Jewish people crossed by on the other street because they had other side of the street because they had other things to do and they were scared something happened to them. So they went, but this Samaritan, he came by and he was neighborly to him and he fixed him up and took care of him. Okay. And the other time was another time when Jesus healed the 10 lepers and they went to town and says, hey, we're healed, we can go back to our families. And there's one guy who, when he realized he was healed, he turned around and comes back and worships Jesus. And Jesus says, and he's a Samaritan. We're the other nine. I mean, they're my home folks. Didn't they come back? Samaritans, you understand, they didn't like them. And the point is that you have the River Jordan, and you have Jerusalem is down here. This is from your perspective, okay? Jerusalem's down here, and the Northern Kingdom up here is, and that's where, Shechem is one of the, where they, when they divided the kingdoms, that's where they worshiped, up here. And so you had the Samaritan land was west of the Jordan River. Well, when the Jews were coming from Galilee down to Jerusalem, Jesus' time was going through. But most of the time, they crossed the Jordan River on the eastern side and came down and then crossed back at Jericho, if not sooner, to go into Jerusalem. They didn't even go into the Samaritan land. They avoided it all the time. And so when Jesus showed up at the well and the woman comes out to get water, and what time did she come? 6 o'clock. Yeah, that's noon. Yeah, they start their time from 6 o'clock in the morning is one. And so she's coming out in the heat of the day to draw water. Well, that's not when anybody else comes to draw water. It's too hot. It's hard work carrying it back. So, but everybody else comes either in the cool of the morning or the cool of the evening. So why didn't she? Well, because they ostracized her because she was not of a good reputation, as we soon learned. Yeah. Not a good reputation person. You know, the other women didn't like her. She had cornered more than her share of husbands. And so she's out there at noon because she's enough shame as it is. Well, then you had this exchange, and Jesus talked to her. That surprised her because she recognized him as a Jew. And Jews don't talk to Samaritans, much less a Samaritan woman. And he says, just give me a drink. And she says, why are you talking to me? And she says, well, you know, if you knew who it was that was talking to you, you would ask him for water because he has water that when you drink his water, you never thirst again forever. And you just see the brain going in her head. She says, water? That I don't have thirst anymore? You mean I don't have to come out here and get it? I don't have to carry it? Hey, give me some of that water. Give it to, you know, where can I get this stuff? Give me a year's supply. Jesus said, go get your husband and bring him out. Yeah. We have that same thing today, even. You know, go get your husband and then you can sign the contract. How many women have encountered that? Yeah. Okay. See, it's an ancient tradition. Go get your husband. We'll fix this. Okay. Now, but she says, but I have no husband. And Jesus says, you're right. You're absolutely right. You've had five husbands, but the man you're living with now is not your husband. And she, that's enough of this stuff. I'm going to change the subject. I perceive that you're a prophet. Today we'd say psychic. I perceive that you're a psychic. And oh, by the way, as long as you're, you know, a psychic of this, you say, the Jews say that the only place to worship is in Jerusalem. But we have a lot of credible evidence as to the holiness of the place in Shechem where we work. That's where Abraham came. Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, they worship God at this place. The history of Jerusalem is, but Shechem has so much liturgical background. And they said, Jesus said, the time is coming when neither in Jerusalem or in Shechem are you going to be worshiping. God is looking for people to worship in spirit and truth. In spirit and truth. Because the worship is not a thing and a process. Worship is a way of life before God. And Jerusalem is going to be destroyed. Shechem has already been and will continue to be. And it's, you know, so the place and how we exercise, but it's whom you're worshiping is an important part. And she said, we know that the Messiah is coming, the one called the Christ. See, Messiah is Hebrew and Christ is Greek. Okay, so it's the same word, the anointed one. We know that the anointed one is coming. And Jesus says, I am he. That's all that's on the back of the bulletin. Isn't it? And then you got the rest of the story, because what happens from there? But he made a change in her life. She met the Messiah, and she recognized him and accepted that, and it changed her life immediately. That's why I'm glad we got the rest of the story, or parts of it anyway. They left that part. But anyway, the part of it, and she left her jar right there. That was no longer important. The object lesson was no longer important. She had the real thing in front of her, the Messiah, she thought. And she turns around, runs back to town, and says, hey, I think the Messiah is here. He told me everything that I have done. Everybody else knew it. Everybody else knew her business. But the Messiah, they went out with her. They went out with her. Not her husbands, but her community now is curious because of her witness to them. And they follow her out. And they listen to Jesus. And he gives them his word. And they believe. And they say, please stay with us a few days. Please stay with us a few days. And he consents. He stays with them until it comes to the time, this glorious moment. Every evangelist prays for is when they say, I love Jesus, not because you told me, but because he told me and shown me that he loves me enough to die for me. And it changes lives. It changed her life. It changed her relationship to the community. It changed that community because of her meeting and believing the Messiah. Because she received the living water. The water itself, it's an object lesson, as it had always been, as was the sacrifices, were object lessons. They were teaching moments that God loves you. He will care for you. But life's still a challenge. I didn't want the alliterations of the bees, but you go on. Okay. Life's a challenge. Why is life? Paul explains it. We have been justified by Christ, by God's grace, through faith. Jesus created the faith in that Samaritan woman. She shared that faith with the community, and they came, and Christ gave it to them as well. And that's how he described it. He pours out the Spirit to them. It's a wartime terminology. He poured out upon them his Spirit. Why? Because as the Spirit fills you, it flows out of us. The Spirit flows out. He's the one who works in us. We don't even often realize it. But he can, when necessary, when it suits his turn, we can drop the water jug of the moment and witness to the love of Jesus in our lives. And it's not easy doing that in this world. Ever has been. It wasn't easy for her. With the jug, she left her shame. She went back to talk to people who wouldn't talk with her, who wouldn't associate with her. She was anathema like Zacchaeus, the tax collector. But Christ touched her heart and changed it, turned it around. That's what he does with us. It changed. And that's what Paul talks about then. Yeah. In Bible study, and I'm talking now, it's because I've been renewed. It's the difference between the theology of the cross and the theology of glory. The basic differences in that is that the cross, Paul said, I my intention is to preach of Christ and him crucified. What Christ accomplished for us on the cross is what he came to do. That was the whole Old Testament object lessons, from God speaking to Satan in the Garden of Eden, right on down through the whole thing, through the people of promise. That's what he was talking about. He gave that promise. Water is an ongoing symbol, an object lesson through all of that. Now, for the women, what Paul talks about is that we have now been justified by Christ. And now what we do? We live in that hope. And it's not a hope it doesn't snow anymore today or this season. It's the hope that he has guaranteed to us eternal life in Christ Jesus. And that changes it. And Paul sets it down. See, one of the things when I get new people coming in from outside the Christian faith or from other Christian faith groups, And we're in getting into the scriptures and see what the scriptures say about how these things work, and the people's eyes are going, they're like, oh, okay, this is not what I've heard before, and as we go through that, and I say, but let me caution you, that as you have now become grasped by the Holy Spirit, and he is indwelling you in a greater measure than he has before, so that you're hearing and coming to understand what the scriptures are saying in all of this, beware. Because Satan will try to snatch you out of his hand. He will come just as Jesus showed us the day he was baptized. As he came up out of the water from his baptism, the Holy Spirit led him into the wilderness for 40 days to be tempted by the devil. You think when you get a renewal of the Holy Spirit, it's going to lead you into the promised land without a delay? I don't think so. Why? And Paul tells us about that hope. He says, we rejoice in our suffering. Why? Because our suffering builds perseverance, stamina. I watch it. When you're training soldiers, you don't put them in a classroom and tell them what they're supposed to be doing. Any more than you do students. If you tell them you have to, object lesson, act it out, work out something, they had to play with, do it, think it, struggle with it. And so that's what the suffering. And I tell you, the suffering of boot camp is nothing like the suffering in SEALs camp. There is no comparison. So if you're maturing in the faith and you're getting this horrendous suffering in your life, welcome to the SEAL team. Because from suffering comes perseverance, Paul says. And you're strengthened to continue the battle against Satan and against his attempts to take everybody with him. And what else? It builds perseverance, builds character. It builds character. Why do we hold the SEAL teams in such high esteem? Because we have about as much inkling of what they go through to become what they are as we have an inkling of how great heaven is going to be or how horrendous hell is going to be. But God has given us this blessing, and it is ours. And it gives us a character. We have a peace that faces all of these challenges. The Samaritan woman walked back into the very people that had been shaming her for years, deservedly. But she didn't care. She had something more important to tell them, to show them, to express to them. And that character strengthens the hope that is the beginning of all of that. When you're developing the character, it helps it. Now, growing old ain't for sissies. Kelly asked me to put her uncle in our prayers. He's 81 years old, and he's got the onset of dementia. And that's just one of many things of growing old. That's the mind. Usually the body starts a little before that. All right. But even in our physical and our social, in all aspects of living life, God gives us, through word and sacrament, as he pours the Holy Spirit into us, the Holy Spirit strengthens us and it overflows. Psalm 23, my cup overfloweth. That's an object lesson. My cup of the Holy Spirit is, he has filled my cup with his Spirit and it overflows to me for another. And see, now that's your job, like the Samaritan woman, to be filled with the Spirit. And the things, the task of this world, when the opportunities come to proclaim what Christ has done for you, take it. Express it with enthusiasm, with the hope that is built and strengthened by your character, which is developed by your perseverance, which comes from your suffering that you have because you're living in the hope of eternal life in Christ Jesus, that gift of God. In a moment, we're going to gather together to receive his body and blood, the body, the blood, and the water. Again, the water was at the crucifixion as an object lesson. Now we can go into the forensics of it, and we know why it was water. They didn't know that then. The guards did that executed him because they know that the water's coming out, he's dead. It took centuries for us, you know, when people were finally, they were questioning whether Jesus was dead. He just swooned. And he got in the cool grave and he came alive again. No, the guard executed him. He was dead. And he rose again. He died that you might have life. And the object lesson is, spiritual lesson, God joined us in baptism to his baptism, which joins us to his death and his resurrection. And the Holy Spirit fills us that we might pour. It ain't easy till Christ comes. Then it will be perfect peace. Perfect, perfect, perfect. And we will be too. Now we're not. God takes care of us. And that's as we continue, as in our rather than the whole creed today, it's our creed catechism on page 4. It says, as we reflect on how God intersects with his people and graciously meets their physical and spiritual needs, we speak the first article of the Apostles' Creed and its meaning, which relate to the loving work of God the Father for us in Christ Jesus. We stand and confess together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. What does this mean? I believe that God has made me and all creatures, that he has given me my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all my members, my reason, and all my senses, and still takes care of them. He also gives me clothing and shoes, food and drink, house and home, wife and children, land, animals, and all I have. He richly and daily provides me with all that I need to support this body and life. He defends me against all danger and guards and protects me from all evil. All this he does only out of fatherly, divine goodness and mercy, without any merit or worthiness in me. For all this, it is my duty to thank and praise, serve and obey him. This is most certainly true.